بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So today, inshallah ta'ala, as I had promised you, we're going to continue talking about the problematic issues that took place in the time of Ali radiallahu an. And today we're going to talk about, really there's no question about it, the single most difficult and awkward and painful incident in the entire first generation of our tradition. And as I have said many times before, but just in case somebody's only listening to this one lecture, I always have to make this disclaimer. We are intentionally not going to go into a lot of detail. And I explained why in my previous lectures. As Allah says in the Quran, تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ. That is a generation that has gone by in the past. That's a generation that has gone. تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ. They have to answer for what they did. وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ. You have to answer for what you do. And I also mention again that we definitely have a premise. Some would call it a bias, and that's fine. We have a premise, and that is that we believe theologically that the Sahaba are a respected and righteous people, and that none of them would intentionally do something against the interests of the Ummah. And we also believe that the Sahaba are good human beings, but this doesn't mean that they are sinless. It means that they may commit sins, but overall their good is much more than their any mistakes that they might have made. And the sins that they make, inshallah, is trivial compared to the good that they do. As well, there are instances where you can make ijtihad, you can try to figure out what's best, and sometimes you will fall into mistakes. So we need to be very careful when it comes to the Sahaba, and especially Muawiya radiallahu anhu. We're going to talk a little bit about him as well in today's lecture. We have a huge, dichotomy. We have two strands even within our own Sunni Islam. That, especially when it comes to the figure of Muawiyah radiallahu an, that some people go to one exaggeration in making his status more than it is, and others go to the other side and they criticize beyond what is acceptable. And we are, inshallah, in this lecture, I will follow the middle path, and we believe that all of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa radu an, all of them, that includes Muawiyah. But we also believe that not all of the Sahaba are of the same level, that Sahaba have different levels amongst themselves. Like Allah says in the Quran, لَا يَسْتَوِي مِنْكُمْ مَنْ أَنْفَقَ مِنْ قَبْلَ الْفَتْحِ وَقَاتَلُ أُولَٰئِكَ أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً مِنَ الَّذِينَ أَنْفَقُوا بَعْدُ مِنْ فَتْحِ وَقَاتَلُوا وَكُلَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. This is explicit. Not equal are those who embraced Islam before the conquest and who fought jihad before the conquest. لَا يَسْتَوِي. They're not equal. أُولَٰئِكَ, those who embraced Islam and fought, أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. They are a higher level from those who embraced Islam afterwards than the conquest of Mecca. And then Allah says, وَكُلًّا وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. Both groups, Allah has promised Jannah to them. And Muawiyah رضي الله عنه, he definitely is of those who converted. When did he convert?
Just before.
No. That is wrong. When did Muawiyah convert, radiallahu an? After the conquest of Mecca. One of the last batches of converts, as we are going to come to. And so, no one ever in our tradition of the classical history, no one ever said that Muawiyah radiallahu an is of the elite of the Sahaba. He is of the Sahaba, but he is not of the elite of the Sahaba, the people who fought at Badr, Bay'atul Ridwan, the people who were in Khandaq. No, he was not there. He was in Mecca. He embraced Islam at the very end. Another important disclaimer, that unfortunately we have always had from the very beginning of our writing down of knowledge, sectarian understandings of history. What do I mean by this? These incidents define Sunnism and Shi'ism. These incidents define Sunnism and Shi'ism. So when a Sunni writes about these incidents, automatically they have a premise, and that premise is the Sahaba are righteous people. So they will interpret things in a certain manner. And when the Shi'i historians write about this time frame, they automatically have a premise, and that premise is anybody who opposes Ali is not even a Muslim, or a very, very, very bad Muslim. And so the whole lens of history is tainted. And we all know, at least those of us who are involved in these things, which of the two sides is always emphasizing these points of history? Which of the two sides always brings up this period in history? Which of the two sides? The Shia side, right? Because for us, as I keep on saying, why don't we bring it up that much? For multiple reasons. Number one, our religion is independent of what happened in this time frame. That's the main point. What happened didn't happen. Our theology does not change. Aqeedah, iman in Allah, does that change about what happened between the Sahaba? Iman in Quran, iman in Day of Judgment, nothing changes, correct? Our aqeedah is not based on what happened after the death of the Prophet ﷺ. It's history, not theology. Now, as for the other group, their theology is early history. Their entire, and that's why the average Shi'i is 100 times more aware of these incidents than the average Sunni. Because this is their religion for them. This is how they define themselves. They know who said what, and Ali did this, and Fatima did this, and Abu Bakr did this, Umar did this, and some of it might be true, some of it exaggeration, some of it is lies, and the average Sunni is like, I don't know, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدِ. I mean, that's what they know, because their religion is based on the Quran, on the Sunnah. It's not based on these incidents in history. So don't be surprised to discover that the earliest books ever written about these incidents, who wrote them? The Shia side. Now what's going to happen when the first guy is already writing from that perspective? It's a domino effect, right? And so unfortunately, even in Sunni sources, unfortunately, sometimes we have reports that are not coming from our sources, but simply by virtue of the fact that there was nothing else and these guys filled in the blank. And you know, this is not an advanced class. Nonetheless, I'll give you one name that even students of knowledge of history should know. That there is one particular historian from the Shi'i side who wrote around 20 booklets. And I mentioned him when we talked about the Karbala. I mentioned him when we talked about the Karbala because he has the first booklet on Karbala ever written. He wrote it. And all of the narrations of the Shi'a about Karbala go back to this one book. Every story and every, the arrow pierced and the water was deprived and so-and-so died and this and that. The whole tragedy comes back to this one booklet. The same guy, his name is Abu Mikhnaf Lut ibn Yahya. You should memorize this name, and it is well known. Every single, even beginning student of Islamic history knows this name. Because he is the first Shi'i historian. He died 157 AH. That's like similar to Ibn Ishaq, 150, right? Ibn Ishaq died 150. This is even before Imam Malik's death. Abu Hanifa is around this time, right? Imam Shafi'i after this. So this is very early on. And again, what are they interested in? Our scholars are writing seerah and hadith in this time frame. Our scholars, Ibn Ishaq, what is he writing? The life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their scholars are not that interested in that time frame. What are they interested in? Maqtal Hussein. That's the booklet, right? The Mawqi' al-Jamal, the battle of the camel, right? Ma'rakat Siffeen. These are all titles of Abu Mikhlaf Nuh ibn Yahya. He has these booklets. And these booklets were the first things ever written about Siffin. He wrote an entire book on Siffin. A whole book on the Battle of Siffin we're going to do. Another book on Jamal, the Battle of Camel. Another book on Maqtal Hussein. That's the thick booklet that he has. Another book on Maqtal Ali and whatnot. Because again, for them, that is their religion. Now, as for, and of course this person has been studied, you know, throughout history. Many PhDs and dissertations have been written just about this person. I have in my house a number of PhDs and dissertations just about Abu Mikhnaf and about his reports and about how it impacted even Sunni history books. Now this person, Abu Mikhnaf, has zero credibility in our tradition. Imam al-Bukhari, Daraqutni, Ibn Adi, everybody of our tradition said this person is a well-known fabricator. He's a storyteller. He just gives stories. He's not reliable. But guess what? Most of the stories that we know of this time frame, they go back to him, including some stories that perhaps some of you have also heard, such as the details of the arbitration between Abu Musa and between Amr ibn al-As, for example. That's a whole coming from Abu Mikhnaf. Coming straight from him, Lut ibn Yahya. So we have to be extra careful when it comes to these stories. Now, of course, our talk today deals with Muawiyah radiallahu an and what happened between him and Ali radiallahu an. And as Ibn Taymiyyah clarifies, that Muawiyah was of the very last batch of converts, those whom the Prophet technically freed. Remember when he said, "Leave today, you are all free." That's the last batch of converts. That's the very last batch of converts, the tulaqa, the very last batch. And Ibn Taymiyyah writes that Muawiyah was always considered a better person than his father. Who is his father? Abu Sufyan, right? Abu Sufyan was also of this batch of tulaqa. Muawiyah, his iman and taqwa was better than that of Abu Sufyan, but Muawiyah's older brother had even more status in the eyes of the Sahaba and the Prophet ﷺ than him, and his older brother's name was Yazid. So Muawiyah's son, Yazid, was named after his older brother. Okay, is that clear? So Muawiyah's son is named after his brother. His brother is Yazid, then his brother dies, then Muawiyah has a son, Muawiyah calls him Yazid. So Yazid was the one who was appointed by Umar ibn al-Khattab, in fact by Abu Bakr, sorry, even by Abu Bakr, as soon as Damascus was conquered. Abu Bakr appointed, Abu Bakr hadn't been alive at the time, but talk had already begun. Umar was the one in his era appointed Yazid, and then Yazid passes away, natural death, and so Umar appoints Yazid's younger brother, Muawiyah, to be the what? The governor of Damascus and Sham entire, which includes Jerusalem, basically all of Syria. Now, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, therefore, he was based in Sham essentially for the entire caliphate of Umar al-Khattab and Uthman. That's 22 years. And in those 22 years, he establishes a infrastructure and a smooth line bureaucracy that no other province is able to do. And there is no question he was an effective politician. You know, some people are born to be leaders. And he is definitely as well born to be a leader. And his leadership has always been top notch in terms of managing, in terms of running what is assigned to him. And you know, all you need to see is that look in the time of Umar and Uthman radiallahu anhum, how many complaints came about the governors of Kufa, about the governors of Basra. Even there's just a Rolodex, everybody goes in and out. We didn't get into all those details, but I'll just tell you that every few years a major complaint, the people of Kufa say that, and most of them are not valid complaints, right? Because the people are finicky. But Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he never had that problem. He ruled and he was an effective ruler. There was never a major complaint against Muawiyah throughout the time frame of Umar ibn Khattab and Uthman ibn Affan. Now, why is this the case? Well, a number of reasons are given. Some of the scholars say that there's no doubt that as well, one of the main reasons would be that some of the greatest of the Sahaba, they settled in Syria. So Mu'adh ibn Jabal went to Damascus, Ubadah ibn Samit went to Damascus, Abu Darda, all of these great Sahaba, they settled in Damascus. And so because they settled in Damascus, so there's been this trickle down of their knowledge. Secondly, Muawiyah himself was indeed a very effective siyasi person of politics, and there's no denying that he knew how to run a bureaucracy and a government. Thirdly, another reason is given, this is interesting, and that is that the people of Damascus, by and large, were the most cultured of all of the cities that the Muslims were ruling. Because Basra and Kufa were brand new cities. They were established by the Muslims. And the people that were living there were a whole, if you like, hodgepodge of different types of people. They don't have their own culture and civilization. Many of them are never living in cities before. Their own culture is not as refined as that of the people of Syria and Damascus. They're living under Romans. So as it is, the Syrian people, because they had been ruled by the Romans, right? Because remember, Syria was conquered from the Romans, and Syria was basically, it's one of the main intellectual capitals, Damascus. So the Muslims coming in, the people of the city are not like the country folk. They're not like the village dwellers. They are a civilization. And so because of this as well, there's not that much chaos. There's not that much, you know, craziness in this land as it is compared to the other lands. So Muawiyah radiallahu anhu therefore is basically effectively running the entire province of Syria for more than 2.5 decades. Then the fitna happens of Uthman, and the death of Uthman takes place. And this is when the first tensions begin to arise between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. What happened? And I'll be very, very simplistic. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, and I do apologize, but that is what I strongly believe. The less we say, the better it is. So this is going to be a very, very quick, if you like, summary. The first signs of tension came when Ali radiallahu anh sent a governor to replace Muawiyah. So Ali radiallahu anh chose another person to be the governor with a small entourage, with the letter stamped and sealed, and basically said, you're in charge now, and Muawiyah has to step down. Now the question arises, why would he even do that? And the response to this is, frankly, we don't know. There's millions of reasons, not millions, a few reasons are given, a lot of reasons given, but the fact of the matter is we don't know what was in his heart. Why would he do that? Now the common interpretation, which is taken as a fact by non-Muslims, which is ridiculous from our perspective, but it is what you will find in every book written in English, and unfortunately many books written in Arabic and in Urdu and other languages. The common misunderstanding is that the reason why Ali radiallahu anhu did this was because the Banu Hashim and the Banu Umayyah were always rivals in Jahiliyyah. Now this is true. In Jahiliyyah, the Banu Hashim and the Banu, basically the Umayyads, the Banu Abd al-Shams, the Banu Abd al-Shams to the Banu Umayyah, they were rivals and there was always tension between them. That's true. But there's no indication that Ali radiallahu anh did this because of that reason. And this seems to be something that is being read in by outsiders and non-Muslims. So what is the reason? Allah knows best. What we do know, however, is that after the death of Muawiyah and the assassination of Uthman, Ali radiallahu anh essentially changed almost all the governors, in fact all of the major governors. So it's not just Syria. Perhaps he's just turning over a new leaf. Perhaps he's just bringing a whole new administration so that things can run smoothly now from his own perspective. There might also be, Allah knows best, perhaps some ulama, some people have said, and Allah knows best, that there was a fear that since Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and Uthman are cousins, so Uthman and Muawiyah are from the same Banu Umayyah, Banu Abd al-Shams, they're from the same qabila, and they are basically a cousin once removed, so they're very close together. And they were actually close in life as well. So perhaps, some ulama say, there was a fear that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu might do something if he was left in power. But then he did something even though he was asked to leave. So Allah knows best. But there is a theory that there was a fear that if he remained in power, things might get worse. So Ali radiallahu anhu tried to ask him to leave, but then that obviously did not work. It made things worse. In any case, we do not know. In the end of the day, we don't know what was inside Ali radiallahu anhu's heart, what was the reason. But he has the right. I mean, in the end of the day, he's the Khalifa. And for whatever reason, I mean, even if he didn't get along with him, whatever, this is his right as the ruler, as the Khalifa. I mean, sometimes in order to run the company, if two people don't really get along, they move, they're shifted in departments. That's what happens. So whatever reason, we don't know. Ali radiallahu anhu sent the governor with the entourage. Muawiyah heard, he intercepted the governor before they entered Sham, and troops were sent out, and the governor was basically told, you are not welcome, go back. So the governor that was appointed by Ali radiallahu anh is stopped physically, no harm, nobody's hurt, but they're stopped and they're told, you cannot go back where you came from. And so obviously this is effectively a type of rebellion, or yeah, I mean, essentially, like, you're not going to accept what Ali radiallahu anhu is saying. Now, before even Ali radiallahu anhu could do anything, Aisha's situation and Talha and the others started arising in Basra. So he had to pause everything when it comes to Muawiyah and go and deal with that situation in Basra, which we talked about last time. Okay, now in the meantime, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu begins to call for the revenge of the death of Uthman. And one of the relatives of Uthman radiallahu anhu had gone to Damascus with the shirt that Uthman was wearing when he was killed, along with, this is gruesome, some of the fingers of Naila, Uthman's wife. Because remember, when the sword came down, Naila attempted to protect Uthman and her fingers were cut off. So one of the relatives of Uthman, he's basically now going back to Muawiyah, who's another relative of his, and he has these tokens that this is, we need to get the revenge for the killing of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And so Muawiyah says publicly that we demand the vengeance, or the diya, or the dam, basically the blood of Uthman has to be avenged. And these items become public displays in the main Umayyad Masjid. Everybody should see them. Now, can you imagine the visual impact that's going to have? How it will make people emotional, legitimately feel angry. Something has to be done. Where are the killers of Uthman? How could they still be walking? And again, there was this notion, and some of it might perhaps be true, that many of the mobs that were involved in the death of Uthman were now on the side of Ali radiallahu anhu. And that also Aisha radiallahu anhu brings it up, and Talha and Sa'd. So there was this notion that the very people that were involved are basically on that side. And there might be an element of truth, but obviously it was greatly exaggerated as well. So Ali radiallahu anhu has to pause everything, go and deal with the issue of the battle of the camel, the Jamal, deal with Aisha radiallahu anhu and Talha and the other Sahaba over there. And that is in Basra. And when that is done, now he has to figure out what to do with Sham, with Syria. And he decided that there is no other alternative than to march from Basra all the way to Sham, from Iraq to Sham. Because this is basically rebellion, and you cannot run a country if one of the most significant provinces is not in your control. And so Ali radiallahu anhu marched with his army towards Sham, Assyria, and he eventually camped in a plain, a large area outside of basically Damascus by a few days' journey, called Siffeen. So the land is called Siffeen, and it is known to this day, that land. And Siffeen is where the battle took place. This marching took place in the month of Dhul-Hijjah, which is our month right now, Dhul-Hijjah, of 36 AH, right? So 1,401 years ago, in this very month of Dhul-Hijjah. Now, what is the month of Dhul-Hijjah? Haram. Ashhurul Haram. What does that mean?
No fighting.
What is the next month? Muharram. What is Muharram? Also the same, right? So Muawiyah radiallahu anhu Ali radiallahu anhu gets to Siffeen in Dhul-Hijjah, and it is of the Ashhurul Hurum. It is literally Dhul-Hijjah. And so now began a long series of back and forths, lasting for weeks. And it's also the sacred month, so nothing can take place anyway. And it is said that a number of prominent Sahaba visited both sides, attempting to avert a battle. So famous Sahaba, from Ibn Abbas to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, so many of the famous Sahaba, they are worried that this is going to eventually become a battle, which it does. For these few weeks, they're trying their best that it doesn't happen. And Abu Hurairah himself, radiallahu anhu, visited Muawiyah. And he said that, عَلَمَا تُقَاتِلُ, why would you fight? This is the Khalifa. Are you rejecting him to be the Khalifa? And Muawiyah responded to him, radiallahu anhu, I know that Ali is better than me, أفضل مني, and I know that he is more entitled to the Khilafah, and I'm not contesting his position. Now this is very, very important. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was not saying, I am the Khalifa. He never said this until after the death of Ali radiallahu anhu. This is something that is very clear, and no historian worth his salt says otherwise. This is without a shadow of a doubt that Muawiyah radiallahu an was not claiming that Ali's Khilafah is illegitimate and I should be the Khalifa. Rather, what he is saying is, and this is what he told to Abu Hurairah radiallahu an, that I will be forced to fight him until he hands over the Qatalat Uthman or he deals with him himself. And when he takes vengeance for the death of Uthman, then I shall join the rest of the people who have given allegiance. So it is very clear that Muawiyah is saying, I feel obliged as the senior most political authority that's related to Uthman, that it is as if it's my responsibility now. That's what he's basically saying. That it's my responsibility to make sure that Uthman radiallahu anhu's death is avenged, that the people who killed him are brought to justice. And last week I already mentioned why this was effectively impossible, and Ali radiallahu anhu felt that it would cause a great civil war, and he was hoping there would be no other civil war with Aisha and Muawiyah. Turns out their civil wars happened here, and it didn't happen on that side, and لِيَخْضِيَ اللَّهُ أَمْرًا كَانَ مَفْعُولًا. Ibn Taymiyyah also mentions that Muawiyah's camp had this presumption, perhaps some of it might be true, as I said, that the killers of Uthman were literally in the camp of Ali. Now, we cannot believe the killers of Uthman would be in the camp of Ali, but what is without doubt true, those thousands of mobs that were outside of Medina, many of them are now in the army of Ali radiallahu anhu. And this is something well known. You can read the books of history, some of the main leaders of the instigators, whatnot. Now, why he did this and whatnot is honestly, it raises a whole can of worms. But as we had said, that there's ijtihad that both camps did, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows the reality of why they did this. Nonetheless, from the side of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, there was the presumption that number one, the killers are on the other side, and number two, if we don't fight, what happened to Uthman is going to happen to us. So there was an element of self-defense as well. Nonetheless, Ibn Kathir writes that the emissaries went back and forth throughout all of the Ashur al-Hurum until it was clear that really there's not going to be a breakthrough. That both sides, there's no compromise being reached. And so when Muharram finishes and Safar begins, so within a few days of Safar, Ali radiallahu anhu basically announces that there is no chance for reconciliation, so be prepared. And this is following the Sharia, and especially when you're fighting a Muslim, you do not surprise attack. So Ali radiallahu anhu basically says that it's clear 6 weeks have gone by, we are not reaching any impasse, and we're going to have to deal with this matter basically by war. And this is, as I said, a very traumatic incident for all of us from both sides, because this war was not accidental. Unlike the Battle of the Camel, which we can really very easily say that there was no intention for war. But in this case, there's no getting out of it. That when the negotiations did not transpire, then both sides felt there's no way other than actual fighting. And this is the very first intended civil conflict in Islam. And our Prophet ﷺ predicted this, as we'll come to, and he said, the first time the sword is unsheathed within my ummah, it will never be sheathed back ila yawm al-qiyamah. This is a hadith prediction. The first time the sword is unsheathed within the ummah, it will never be put back ila yawm al-qiyamah. And we have constantly seen inter-Muslim fighting and wars, and even now as we speak, one nation is fighting another nation and one is bombing another and whatnot. And this is the reality of the ummah since the time, basically, of this incident. Nonetheless, so on the 6th of Safar, Ali radiallahu anhu announces that there's no point in negotiations and prepare. So on the morning of the 7th, Muawiyah's side was the first to attack because they felt if they don't attack, we're going to be attacked. And so on the morning of the 7th, which was a Wednesday, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, his forces attacked in the grounds of Siffeen, and the two armies fought incessantly for 3.5, 4, some say 5, some say 6, some even say 7 days. They continued to fight Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Some even go on Monday, Tuesday. But Ibn Kathir and others say that basically on Saturday it finished, like 3.5 or 4 days. But they only fought during the day. They did not fight at night. And subhanAllah, this is at one sense you're sad, at another sense you're happy. Both sides would stop for salah time. Both sides would stop for salah time. Both sides would pray janazah over the dead. Because obviously, what's going to happen? They're Muslims, both of them, right? There was an understanding that no person who turned his back and fled would be pursued and killed. Because this was, from both sides' perspective, not the type of offensive war that takes place in ghazwat, in fighting against the enemies and whatnot. There was understanding that if a person is wounded, you're not going to kill him. There was an understanding that there's no ghanima. There's no taking of war booty. Both sides are acting in a manner that is actually, we can say, Islamic to the greatest extent possible, even as they are fighting one another. And that is not going to be replicated ever, by the way. That is not going to, this level of, at least there is an element of basically, fairness, right? On both sides. That is not going to be replicated ever after this. Nonetheless, the armies basically did not, there is no clear victory. There is no clear victory on either camp. And the numbers involved, our books mention staggering numbers. Ibn Kathir says, this is Ibn Kathir, who's one of our most famous historians, 120,000 were on the side of Ali. And of this 120, 40,000 were killed. And 60,000 were fighting on the side of Muawiya, and 20,000 were killed. So Ibn Kathir, who is one of our mainstream historians, is estimating the number of casualties at 60,000 dead. Wallahi, this number, by the way, there are numbers that are more than this and the numbers that are less than this. I just gave you one. This number is just mind-boggling. More Muslims died on the Battle of Siffeen than all the Muslims who had ever died since the beginning of Badr up until pre-Siffeen fighting against the Kuffar. This is the reality. On one day, between the two Muslim armies, more Muslims died at the hands of Muslims than all Muslims who became martyrs from Badr and Uhud and Khandaq and Azab and Khayr, everything, and Qadisiyah, right? And Nahawa, everything combined. And this one battle eclipses all of those. And this is the reality of what is going to, it's a foreshadowing of what's going to happen in the Ummah. Now, I have to point out, this is Ibn Kathir, he's saying 60,000, others say 50, 40, but still, even if it's 40, subhanAllah, just, what can we say? That's a huge amount of people on both sides. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted this. Pretty much all the scholars of hadith understand this hadith I'm about to quote as being a prediction of Siffeen. Obviously, our Prophet didn't say the battle of Siffeen. But there's a hadith in Sahih Muslim. Our Prophet said, hadith is in Sahih Muslim, it's authentic, right? The day of judgment will not come until two large groups of people from my ummah, will fight one another, despite the fact that their call and message is the same. دَعْوَاهُمَا وَاحِدًا. Their message and call, their banners and their rallies, their understanding is exactly the same. But two فِئَتَيْنِ عَظِيمَتَيْنِ, two massive groups of my ummah will be fighting one another, despite the fact that in reality, there is no ikhtilaf. Because here's the sad point. It's not as if Astaghfirullah Ali was saying, I'm not going to take vengeance for Uthman. As we explained last week and 2 weeks ago, he had his own ijtihad of how he would do that. It never actually happened because he's dealing with all of these issues, right? But the methodology, it's not as if he is saying, I don't care, we're not going to take vengeance for Uthman. We showed, I demonstrated that Ali and his sons were protecting Uthman to the very end.
that he was on the side of Uthman, that he wanted and he tried his best, but so the da'wah was wahid, da'wahuma wahid, their call is the same, but tempers flare, emotions got involved, ijtihad was done on both sides, and this reality took place. And another point also, as we mentioned, one of the brothers asked, but this means that's how many of the Sahaba died. Actually, subhanAllah, most of the Sahaba refused to unsheath their swords in this battle. Especially the elite of the Sahaba. Even those that were physically on the sides, many of them refused to actually kill another Muslim. Muhammad ibn Sirin, who is one of the greatest tabi'un, he's a student of Abu Hurairah. Muhammad ibn Sirin, he died in 110 Hijrah. Muhammad ibn Sirin said, so he's a tabi'i, when the fitna reached its peak, when the two battles were fighting, there were 10,000 Sahaba alive, but less than 100 took part in the battle. Then he said, actually less than 30. And you can reconcile this, less than 100 of anybody who had seen the Prophet ﷺ, and less than 30 of the elite of the Sahaba. Less than 30 of the big names participated. The bulk of the Sahaba, the bulk of them, refused to fight another Muslim. Even if their hearts were on one of the two sides, like in the sense they support one side against the other, but they're not going to reach blows, they're not going to kill. And many of the Sahaba, they specifically said to either Ali or Muawiyah radiallahu anhu that we cannot go this far. I'm not going to unsheathe my sword against another Muslim, right? Even if I support you against this cause or whatnot, but not this. So the actual number of Sahaba who were on both sides, we said less than 30 of the famous ones, and maybe 60 of those whose names weren't even, you know, because in Hajjatul Wada', how many Sahaba? 100,000, right? Of those groups that we don't even know their names, the people who saw the Prophet ﷺ, and they, of them, maybe there were 60, 70, maybe. And of the elite, less than 30. However, there was one in particular that became the big name in this battle, and that is Ammar ibn Yasir. That is Ammar ibn Yasir. Ammar ibn Yasir, of course, is one of the most famous of the Sahaba. His father, of course, Yasir, whom I'm named after, was the first martyr, male martyr in Islam. His mother, Sumayya, was the first martyr. You all know the stories, go back to the very beginning of the seerah. Ammar himself was taken and dragged and tied up and tortured to the point of he could not even think straight. And he could not even understand what he is saying. That's how bad he was tortured. And he was a teenager. Like, he was literally in front of him. It's a really tragic story. Went over this in the seerah how many years ago. He's seen his own mother and father die in front of him, tortured to death. Now they're taking him, the poor kid, you know. And they begin to torture him to death as a teenager. And he's a teenager, so he buckles under the pressure. And he praises the gods and says whatever they ask him to say. So they let him go, and he comes running to the Prophet, you know, bloodied and bruised and whatnot. He comes running and he says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm destroyed, you know, what happened? And so he says that I was tortured to the point of I didn't even know what I was saying. And then I just said what they wanted me to say. So the Prophet said, Kayfa tajid qalbak? How do you find your heart? So he said, Mutma'innun bil iman. It is still firm in iman. My heart is still firm in iman. And so Allah Azza wa Jalla reveals Surah An-Nisa. We recite it to this day. It's in the Quran, right? Illa man ukriha wa qalbuhu mutma'innun bil iman. This is what Ammar said. What Ammar said is in the Quran. Mutma'innun bil iman. It's in the Quran. That Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying that whoever says kufr, except the one who was forced, and his heart is mutma'in bil iman. So he made that exception for all people. So Ammar was the one who opened the door for that exception. So Ammar is that teenager who then migrates to Abyssinia, comes back, migrates to Medina. So he does both migrations. So he's of that status. Participates at Badr, so he's a Badri. And Uhud, and Khandaq, and Hudaybiyah. So he is of the elite of the Sahaba, the highest category of the Sahaba. And one day the Prophet ﷺ said to him, and this hadith is mutawatir, it's in so many books of hadith, Bukhari and Muslim, they all have it. One day the Prophet ﷺ said to him, وَيْحَكَ يَا عَمَّارُ تَقْتُلُكَ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةُ. Woe to you, or careful. وَيْحَك here means, be careful. كُنْ عَلَى حَذَر. Be careful. وَيْحَك, or woe to you, as we would say, وَيْحَك يَا عَمَّارُ. The group that has rebelled, is going to be the one that will kill you. This hadith is authentic like the sun. The group that has rebelled will be the one that will kill you. تَقْتُلُكَ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةُ. Now Ammar ibn Yasir was a staunch ally of Ali radiallahu anhu, the right hand man of Ali from the beginning. And he participated in the battle of Siffeen. And at this stage, he is now around 90 years old now. Around 90 years old, he's in the battle of Siffeen now. And he, and in fact, it is said that he had his spear, and he was putting his spear on the ground, like, you know, hitting it, hammering it, and saying, I fought with the Prophet three times with this very spear. And this is the fourth time, you know, I'm going to be using this spear. So he's on the side of Ali radiallahu anhu against the side of Muawiya. And on the third or fourth day of the battle, he felt that this was his last day. He just felt it. It's a premonition. These are people, Allah Azza wa Jal gives them these feelings from Allah Azza wa Jal. He felt that this is it, I'm going to be dying. So he called his servants or whatever, he said, bring me some milk. They said, why? He said, the Prophet said to me, milk will be the last thing you drink before you die. So I want to fulfill that hadith. So milk was brought to him, he drank it, and he went into battle and he was killed. Now which side killed him? So the death of Ammar ibn Yasir became a sign, because all the Sahaba knew the hadith. All the Sahaba knew the hadith. In fact, Ali radiallahu anhu himself picked up the body of Ammar and led it in janazah. Again, because this is now a sign that which of the two sides is more closer to the truth, right? Now, how did the other side interpret this? How did the other side interpret it? Because the hadith is known, isn't it? The hadith is well known. The Prophet said it. In fact, in all likelihood, he said this more than once, because we have it from so many sahaba. When the masjid is being built of Quba, masjid of the Prophet is being built, multiple times he said, woe to you, O Ammar, the Baghiya group is going to kill you. How did the other side interpret this? Well, subhanAllah, where there's a will, there's a way. Where there's a will, there's a way. And this is the reality of all of us, that when we want to find a way out, we'll find a way out. When somebody came to Muawiyah radiallahu anh and said to him that Ammar has died today, and the hadith said that the Baghiya group is the one going to kill him, and our group killed him. So what was the response of Muawiyah radiallahu anh? He said, woe to you, we're not the ones who killed him. The ones who brought him to the battle are the ones who caused his death. Flipped it around, 180. The ones who brought it to the battle are the ones who brought around about his death. And Ibn Kathir narrates this from Muawiyah radiallahu anh, and said this is a very far-fetched interpretation of the hadith. The point though, we have to be very clear here. Muawiyah radiallahu anh did not intend to reject or disobey what the Prophet ﷺ said. He had an interpretation that some would label far-fetched. Ibn Kathir himself says, هذا تأويل بعيد. That's like bizarre. It's Ibn Kathir saying this, right? That's just not very... But these interpretations are in reality coming from some type of iman. You understand what I'm saying here? Like, he does not want to be the one that is baghi. And this shows that he has some iman, that he does not want to be the one that's rebelling. And so he's trying to reason with himself, justify to himself, how can I not be the one? So then he brings out this interpretation, and Allah Azza wa Jal will account him for his niyyah. Right? Innamal a'malu bin niyyat. Whether it's right or wrong, Allah Azza wa Jal is so rahim, he judges people based on niyyah and not based on actual being correct or not. And there are many instances, such as the man of the Bani Israel, who felt that if Allah resurrects me, I'm going to go to Jahannam, so I'm going to make sure Allah never resurrects me. The hadith is in Bukhari, right? And so what does he do? He tells his children, when I die, burn my body incinerate. You know, cremation was not known to the Arabs, or cremation was not common. So he thought, if I cremate my body, Allah cannot resurrect me. And this is kufr, isn't it? Because you're thinking that you can outwit Allah. You're smarter than Allah, you can go. So he said to his children, cremate my body, distribute the ashes everywhere, and so then I don't have a problem of Yawm al-Qiyamah. I'd rather not have Yawm al-Qiyamah. So Allah Azza wa Jal caused the wind to bring all of the ashes, said kun fayakun. The man stood in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment, and Allah asked him, this is in the hadith, Allah asked him, ma hamalaka ala hada, why would you do this? And so the man said, khashyataka ya Rabb, I'm scared of you. And being scared of Allah is iman. And so Allah forgave him because of his fear. Now this hadith is a principle is derived that Allah bases judgment on what? On niyyah. The guy's action necessitates a rejection of Allah's power. But he's not doing it that, I'm smarter than Allah. He's a simple guy. His mind was like, you know what? I'd rather not face Jannah and Jahannam. Let me just live this life and forget about it. I'm worried about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment. So I'd rather not face it. Simple-minded guy. Now, I'm not saying Muawiyah is not simple. He's very poor. But I'm just saying, the point is that, what was this man judged on? Niyyah. And that's my point. No matter how far-fetched Muawiyah radiallahu anhu's interpretation is, in his heart, he did not want to be the Baghi group. And that's why he's finding a way out. That's not me, that's them. And in that finding way out is iman. Because he does not want to be the Baghi group. And Allah Azza wa Jal will obviously judge people on their intentions. So in any case, so Ammar's death really caused, Ammar ibn Yasir's death really caused the climate, if you like, to change. And it is said on the next day, basically, the fighting ceased. On the next day, the fighting ceased. How did the fighting cease? This was the infamous incident that took place that Muawiyah radiallahu anhu's side decided to tie their Qur'ans. Now pause here. In those days, Qur'ans were massive scrolls, massive pieces of paper. Not like the nice little pocket Qur'ans that we have here. These were huge parchments, right? At times bigger than this table maybe. Massive size. So they decided to take some of these, you know, leather parchments and paper and tie it to their lances and spears and raise it up high. Raise it up high to show respect to the Qur'an, that look, I cannot use my weapon to fight you now. The Qur'an's on there. I can't use my weapon to fight you. And they began to say that, let us now stop this fighting and turn to the Qur'an to judge between us. Tahakum, the arbitration from the Qur'an. The Qur'an will judge between us. Now, here we have the one of the riwayat of Abu Mukhnaf Lut ibn Yahya, who basically blames Amr ibn al-As for this tactic. That he says this was a deceitful tactic, that Amr ibn al-As saw that he was losing, and so he did this. And this is Abu Mukhnaf, it's not something that we consider to be valid. Nonetheless, when the Qur'an was raised, so Ali radiallahu anhu's troops could not fight because you have the Qur'an there. And this is, in our religion, we all know, we respect the Mus'haf. We all know this, right? The Mus'haf has the utmost respect. That's why, you know, we show respect to the actual copy of the Qur'an. We have to have wudu to touch it. The woman in Mensa should not touch it. We don't put it on the ground. All of these things we know. We show respect to the actual Mus'haf. So when the Mus'haf was raised up, Ali's troops as well, lowered their lances, they're not going to fight. And Ali radiallahu anhu said that, I am the first person to take the Qur'an as the guide. I'm the first person to take the Qur'an as the arbitration, that I am not going to say no to this. And so eventually what was decided was that each group would pick one judge, one ambassador, and these two judges or ambassadors, there's arbitration would take place, and the two of them would figure out how to resolve the tension. So Ali radiallahu anhu chose Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he chose Amr ibn al-As. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari and Amr ibn al-As. Now, the fact of the matter is that details of the arbitration are vague in every report other than Abu Mikhnaf's one. And the version that many of you have read and heard is coming straight out of the Abu Mikhnaf version of history. And we don't accept that version. In Abu Mikhnaf's version, you all know what happened. And that was essentially, that's the wrong version. Amr tricked Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. This is the version that is well known and popular. Everybody hears this version, that Amr is portrayed as a cunning, evil, sly politician, and Abu Musa is portrayed as a naive simpleton. And this is not correct. The both of them were intelligent, and the both of them were politically savvy. This is simply not correct. But Abu Mikhna's version has this twist and whatnot. And I'm not even going to, for those of you who don't know, there's no need to mention. I know many of you know the details of Abu Mikhna's version, but this is not found in the other books of history. Rather, what appears to be the case is that the conditions seem to be generic. That fighting is going to cease, that for the time being, Muawiyah can remain in Syria, and Ali radiallahu anhu is basically in Iraq, that the two of them are not going to attack the other side. There's not going to be any more war, and that we need to now do further discussions to bring about a full resolve of the tensions. Essentially, the truce did not flesh out the details of how the truce would take place. The truce was simply, both sides were tired of killing one another, and they said, you know what, we just have to stop this, we're not going to fight, you each stay in your realm and whatnot. And there probably was this notion, and there are reports that, okay, next year we're going to meet again, and we're going to meet again, but both sides got busy in other matters, and they never went to war again, but they never quite solved the tensions as well. And Ali radiallahu anhu was eventually assassinated by the major problem that took place after the Battle of Siffeen, which he had to deal with for the next 3 years. And that's one of the reasons why he couldn't deal with Muawiyah as well. And that is the issue of the Khawarij. We'll talk about that inshallah next week, inshallah. Next week, next Wednesday, will be a little bit of theology, a little bit of history, and that is the Khawarij. And by the way, that's very important because it deals with the modern ISIS and Al-Qaeda and all of that as well, because these are manifestations of the Khawarij as well. So after this, of course, Ali and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, they never went to war again, but they never actually solved their tension. And eventually, within 3 years after this, Ali radiallahu anhu is assassinated. And after this, Muawiyah then declares himself to be the Khalifa. As long as Ali was alive, Muawiyah never challenged his status as Khalifa. He never came under him technically. He never gave him the bay'ah. He never gave him the oath of allegiance. And he kept on saying that when you resolve the Uthman issue, I'll give you the oath of allegiance. So theoretically, he's acknowledging that Ali is the Khalifa, but he is saying, I can't give you my oath until you solve that problem. And that problem was never solved. Ali is radiallahu anhu is killed, and so Muawiyah then declares himself to be the Khalifa. So let us briefly comment a little bit about this Battle of Siffeen and how we are to interpret it. Ibn Taymiyyah writes that by unanimous consensus of the ulama of Islam, Ali radiallahu anhu is the better of the two and the more correct and the more rightly guided. Now pause here. The Shia accuse us of being on the side of Muawiyah. And this is simply wrong. This is simply wrong. And I said this when I talked about Karbala. We are the real Shia to Ali. I said this. And I meant it. And it is something that we Sunnis theologically believe. This is a false accusation against us that the Sunnis are from on the side of Muawiyah. No. We are the real Shia to Ali. We are the real supporters of Ali, and this is Ibn Taymiyyah, whom the Shia think is like their worst hater of Ali radiallahu anhu, and it's not true. Look what he's writing. This is straight from his book, Minhaj al-Sunnah. Ibn Taymiyyah has a 10-volume book. It is the most comprehensive book ever written in the history of Islam, pre-modern, about the differences between Sunnism and Shiaism, and the critique of Shiaism from Sunnism. This is the most comprehensive book, 10 thick volumes. And in this book he writes that by unanimous consensus of all Sunni ulama, Ali was ahaqqu bil khilafa wal imama. Ali was the one who was better suited and in charge of being in charge of the ummah, and that there is no doubt that, you know, Muawiyah made an ijtihad, and that ijtihad no doubt was the less correct of the two. So Ibn Taymiyyah is now technical here, because he is saying, our Prophet ﷺ said, if a leader or a ruler makes ijtihad, he tries to form something, and he's correct, he'll get a double reward. If he's incorrect, he will get a single reward. So Ibn Taymiyyah says, even if Muawiyah was mukhti, and mukhti means he was wrong, even if Muawiyah was mukhti, Allah Azza wa Jal will still give him a single reward. And this is the Sunni point, that we do not accuse Muawiyah of astaghfirullah kufr or nifaq. But we say Ali was better than him, without a doubt, and the Sahaba who refused to fight were the best in terms of this issue. They weren't better than Ali overall. Ali is better than any Sahabi alive right now. But in this issue, those who refused to fight both sides were the ones who had the safest and the best position. And he also pointed out, and this is something very important for us, this battle that took place was a battle of politics and not aqidah. It was a fight that deals with siyasa and not deen. Neither of the two sides accused the other of heresy, of kufr, of nifaq, of deviation. They are praying janazah over the dead of each other. And there are even reports, and Allah knows how true they are, but it is not surprising at all. It is not surprising at all, but Allah knows how true they are, that at times when salah was taking place, they would pray in one jama'ah, even if they have to go and fight on the other side. Now, it's not at all bizarre if you understand the mentality of what's going on. The ikhtilaf was not over deen. So why would they mind praying behind other people? The notion of the other side being deviant did not come to their minds. The notion is you're wrong. Yes. Politically wrong, not theologically wrong. So this is a khilaf siyasi, not a aqadi. And he says, and this is something very awkward, but it is probably true, that on both sides words were uttered that were very harsh. And we're not going to mention those words. As I said many times, you know, if your mother and father have a fight, you don't regurgitate each and every phrase. You let it be. Life goes on. And we respect Muawiyah and we respect Ali more than Muawiyah. And words were exchanged. Some of the books record these words. We turn away from them. We don't find any benefit in regurgitating, he said this, he said that, this was said about him, this was. It's a war. People are dying. Yes, tempers are going to rise. Perhaps even Ali and Muawiyah said things about not each other's deen, but that, you know, this is whatever. They might have said things. Let's leave it at that. But it's understandable. And so Ibn Taymiyyah points out that, you know, it's a harsh words that we don't have to think too deeply about them. It's a war going on. There's anger going on. And the main point is that Muawiyah never proclaimed himself as Khalifa, nor even did he challenge Ali's right to be Khalifa. But it is true that when Ali died, yes, that was when Muawiyah took the oath of allegiance of Khilafah. That was when. And he did not accept Hassan's oath, which is Ali's son in Kufa. He did not accept Hassan's oath. And eventually, of course, Hassan radiallahu anhu would basically acquiesce and give up. Now, as for Muawiyah radiallahu himself, his persona is one of the most controversial within Sunni Islam. It's not controversial for the Shia. They hate him, they despise him, they don't view him as a Muslim by and large. But even within Sunni Islam, unfortunately, we've always found some tension. Out of all of the Sahaba, no Sunni ever says anything disparaging about the elite, or else they wouldn't be Sunni. Unfortunately, we do have some of our ulama, especially modern mufakkirin, I should say, modern thinkers, right? They kind of went beyond what is permissible. And they said things about the akhlaq and character of Muawiyah that they should not have said. And the fact of the matter is that he was a Sahabi, that he was of the last batch of converts, and therefore he just got the honor of being a Sahaba, but that because he's of the last batch, he cannot be compared with the first batches. Also, he was the brother-in-law of the Prophet ﷺ. How can we ignore that? Because his sister is who? Umm Habiba binti Abi Sufyan. right? And so Muawiyah is a brother-in-law of the Prophet ﷺ, and that cannot be ignored. As well, Muawiyah radiallahu anh was chosen for a brief period of time to be of the people who wrote the Quran when it was revealed, the Kutab al-Wahi. He was of those who were chosen because his background was educated. And there were very few educated people in Mecca. We know this. Abu Sufyan was a politician and he was educated. And his sons were educated. And so Muawiyah was chosen by the Prophet to be of the Kutab al-Wahi. This is well known. Ibn Sa'd, everybody of the classical book says this. The fact that he wrote the Quran for a period of time, if you're going to doubt him, you're doubting the Quran. If you're going to doubt his character, you're doubting the Prophet's choice in asking him to write the Quran. And we don't cross that line. As well, there are some hadith that seem to indicate indirectly or directly the blessings of Muawiyah. Of them is hadith in Muslim Ahmad that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed for Muawiyah that he Allahumma ja'alu hadiyan mahdiya. This is a famous hadith. Allahumma ja'alhu hadiyan mahdiya. He saw Muawiyah and he made a dua for him. That, oh Allah, make Muawiyah somebody who is guided and who guides other people. Hadiyan mahdiya. So this is dua in Muslim Imam Ahmad. And it is also reported in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam praised the first group of Muslims who would ride the waves in ghazwa, in jihad. The first naval expedition. And Umm Salama was there and she asked the Prophet to make dua that she is of them. And she was of them, and that is why she was of the group of Sahaba who invaded which land? Cyprus, Qubrus, right? And that's why her grave is still over there to this day. Literally, the masjid is next to the beach. It's on the beach. The masjid attached to her is on the beach because that's where she died. Who was in that group as well is Muawiyah. Muawiyah was one of the leaders of that group. And our Prophet ﷺ said that group shall be a forgiven or a blessed group. There are different versions of the hadith. That group is a forgiven group. And Muawiyah is a part of that group. So Muawiyah has the blessing of being of that group that the Prophet ﷺ praised. And there is no question that Muawiyah radiallahu anh effectively managed to rule over Syria during his lifespan. And then when he became the Khalifa, he became the most effective king the Ummah has ever seen. Because he became a king, as we know. He put his son in charge. He became the most effective dynastic ruler the Ummah has ever seen. And the only ruler who was a Sahabi. The only dynasty ruler who's a Sahabi, right? Because who after him was a Sahabi and a dynastic ruler, meaning a king ruler. And Imam al-Awza'i, one of the famous scholars of Syria who died in the era of the Tabi'un, Imam al-Awza'i said that many of the Sahaba were alive in the time of Muawiyah. None of them challenged Muawiyah's rule. None of them. After Ali's death, none of the Sahaba rebelled against Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, including Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who rebelled in Mecca and Hijaz. When did he rebel? For those who know history, after Muawiyah's death. Yazid. After Muawiyah's death is when he really rebelled against the Khilafah. Before that time it was tension, I would say. But the actual proclamation, if you like, this is afterwards that took place. And in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, there's a beautiful narration that says that Muawiyah radiallahu anh wrote to Aisha. Aisha is alive when Muawiyah becomes the Khalifa. He wrote to Aisha, give me some advice and be short. Give me some quick advice, short advice. And so Aisha wrote to him, this hadith is in Tirmidhi. Aisha wrote to him, Assalamu alaikum. I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, Man ibtagha rida Allahi bi sakhat al-nas, whoever seeks the pleasure of Allah, even if it means displeasing the people, Allah will take care of the people for him. And whoever seeks the pleasure of the people by disobeying Allah, Allah will leave him to the mercy of the people. Wassalamu alaikum. This is the hadith. Simple, sweet, short, to the point. But what does it show us? Good relations, and that Muawiyah wants spiritual advice. The fact that he's writing to Aisha and says, give me some advice, I want to hear something that will benefit me. What does that show us about the character of Muawiyah radiallahu anha? So all of this cannot be ignored. And we, and especially myself, I'll be very, very clear here, I do not at all agree with a group of thinkers of our times. Some of these are founders of Islamic parties and movements. I don't want to go beyond this. Many of you look up to these individuals. These are modern thinkers in the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s who are founders of these political movements. They felt that the problems of Islam began with Muawiyah. These are Sunni thinkers. That Muawiyah changed the Khilafah Rashida into a kingdom and dynasty. And it's too deep and too profound to, or too much to detail go into this, but honestly, it is naive simplicity to assume that if Muawiyah hadn't done anything, we would still have had a Khilafah Rashida. All you need to do is to look at Ali radiallahu anhu's reign and how much fitna happened in his time. Even though he is way better than Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, but he could not quell the rising tide of whatever, instability, whatnot. And the fact of the matter is, I believe, and we Sunnis should believe this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used Muawiyah when he needed to be used as the Khalifa. And he was the most effective Khalifa for his generation. And honestly, if you look at it from a neutral standpoint, he was an amazing leader. He managed to transform the religion of Islam into a global civilization. He was the single-handed person who changed the dynamics of Islam from being something that literally has not been exposed to the world. It's still coming out of the culture of Arabia, and he makes it the beginnings of a global civilization. And that's the Umayyad dynasty overall, and especially Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. And he is the only king of our history who was also a Sahabi. No king after him was a Sahabi. And there's no question that having a dynasty is not the default and the ideal. But we also have to be clear here. Being a dynasty doesn't disqualify you from being a Khalifa. And if you believe this, then essentially you are saying we have never had a Khilafah for the last 1,400 years. And that's ludicrous. What are the Umayyads, the Abbasids, the Mamluks, the Zanjavids, the Ayyubids, the Ghaznavids? I mean, every single sultanate, every single Khilafah has been dynastic for the bulk of our history. Because frankly, it's easier for a civilization to understand, okay, this is the family that's going to rule us. And the world works in a more better way in this regard, even if it has problems. There is no ideal when it comes to this. The Khilafah Rashida has gone away. Bottom line, I'm going on and on, and we need to finish up here. The bottom line, Muawiyah radiallahu anh is somebody whose character and whose iman and taqwa is beyond dispute. That's beyond the red line. We may disagree with his ijtihad in how he handled the situation, but we don't ever impugn his niyyah. We don't talk about his character as being bad. We may disagree, and it does appear that his rebellion against Ali radiallahu anh was not the better of the two ijtihads. But in the end of the day, what happened happened, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deal with them based on their niyyah. And we also believe that if you look at what he did afterwards by establishing the Umayyad dynasty, and by, the Umayyad dynasty as well is another dynasty that a lot of dhulm is done against it. The fact of the matter is, once again, we have never had a dynasty as effective as the Umayyads, despite its flaws, despite its negativities, and there are negatives. The Umayyad dynasty overall for 90 years, it was the only dynasty that was completely uniting the Ummah. After the fall of the Umayyads, what happened? The Ummah split up. You had Andalus, you had the Baghdad, the Abbasids as well. Eventually you had the Safavids, the Mughals, the Hamanids. You had all of these fractures. In the time of the Umayyads, it was one. From Sin all the way to Maghrib, from Morocco all the way to China, you had the Umayyads ruling. One Khilafah. We've never had that since that time. The Umayyads as well were the only dynasty where the conquests were still taking place at the same level as that of the time of the Sahaba. When the Sahaba's expansion, the Umayyads continued all the way to China and to not even Morocco. Where did they go?
Spain.
They entered Europe, right? This is the time of the Umayyads. The Abbasids did nothing compared to that. And the Ottomans did nothing compared to that. And the Mamluks did nothing compared to that. And the Ayyubids and the Hamanandids did nothing compared to that. So the Umayyads, indeed, some tragedies happened like Karbala and whatnot, major tragedies, no question. But in the grand scale of things, we have never had a dynasty as powerful and as effective and yes, as humble even. How so? And again, I go into my tangents here, but the way that the Umayyads lived was not like the way the Abbasids and the Ottomans lived. The Umayyad Khalifa intermingled with the people. He lived amongst the people. He gave the khutbah and led the salah and jumu'ah, whereas later on the Khalifa is not even qualified. And these days, we don't even want our leaders to recite Fatiha, or they're going to embarrass themselves, as we see YouTube videos all the time. Yeah, the world has changed. The Umayyads were people, generally speaking, of iman and taqwa. They had some knowledge. They were in charge of the ummah. They had so much khair in them. Yes, they had major problems. But compared to what happened afterwards, they were light years ahead of the rest of the later generations. In any case, so the bottom line is the Battle of Siffeen is a great tragedy. And we simply ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive both sides, and we move on and we don't dwell too deeply about that time frame. Inshallah, next week we'll talk about the Khawarij and the assassination of Ali, and then move on to the other Sahaba. We have a very important announcement, inshallah, before our Salah. And that is, alhamdulillah, as you know, MIC has been looking for a youth director. Alhamdulillah, we now have Brother Safi. You can stand up, Safi, it's all right. Alhamdulillah, everybody knows Safi, mashallah. Safi Khan has been appointed our youth director, alhamdulillah. We felt that he is the most qualified person because he is a member of our own community. Rather than get somebody from outside, we know Brother Safi, inshallah, will be very effective in this role. And inshallah, any youth-related activities and all complaints now can be directed to him, inshallah. So I have now cleansed my hands of youth affairs, and it all goes on his shoulder. But inshallah, he'll do fine, inshallah ta'ala. Okay.
If anybody will face a power against Muawiyah and his kids, not going to last long. That's true or not?
No, there's no hadith like this. No. There's no hadith like this. Nothing like this. Yeah, when it comes to these types of blessings about these, it's most literature that we read, it's not found in the classical sources, inshallah. Yes? About who? Not every single qatil al-maqtul. Not every single. This is the general rule that when they fight for an illegitimate cause, then indeed al-qatil al-maqtul fil-nar. But this is, as we mentioned a few weeks ago, in the class, in the hadith class that we're doing, Riyadh al-Salihin. What is the Sunni rule when it comes to wa'id, when it comes to punishments? What is the rule that Sunnis have when it comes to punishments and threats in the Quran and Sunnah? When Allah threatens punishment, what is the rule? Do you remember the rule? We mentioned it. The rule is that the threat of punishment is generic and we do not apply it to specific people because the default of a Muslim is forgiveness. So the threat is general. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, or the hadith says, that whoever drinks khamr, this is going to happen. Or when the Quran says, whoever eats the orphan's money is eating jahannam, right? But now you see the Muslim and he's drinking. Are we going to say you are going to jahannam? No. Because Allah will weigh that one evil with all of the other good. And Allah will judge based on the good and the evil combined. And the default when it comes to a Muslim is forgiveness. So when it comes to the Sahaba, the default is even higher than this. And therefore, radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhum. Okay, inshallah, with that we pause and continue next week. Inshallah ta'ala, bismillah.